Come with me as once more we delve into English medieval social history. Why did the French find it so difficult to destroy the English armies of the Hundred Years' War? Hey guys, welcome back to Social History Sunday. Now, generally speaking, when I've been making these videos, it's quite difficult to separate the social from the political and the military history of medieval England, because quite a lot of the time these subjects are all tied up together. With this subject I'm not even going to try, and we're looking at the Hundred Years' War. Now, the Hundred Years' War isn't really my time period, but I think it's really quite interesting because it does tie back into the historic period that I'm interested in. I'm primarily an Edward I, late 13th, early 14th kind of guy. I don't usually pay that much attention to the Hundred Years' War, but from the point of view where I'm going to look at it, it's actually quite interesting, because I think that the English didn't lose the Hundred Years' War. We lost it politically, but not militarily. What do I mean by that? Well, towards the end of the Hundred Years' War, as the French were becoming more and more reliant on gunpowder weapons, like cannon, etc., our allies on the continent, the Gascons, for instance, Gascony, I think they just got fed up with the constant, and they'd lost quite a few battles against the French, they'd lost quite a few castles in sieges, and I think the Gascons and other allies had just had enough. So they decided that enough was enough and let's have peace. So we lost quite a chunk of logistic capability on the continent, and as a result we ended up signing a peace treaty with the French, and they technically won the war politically. Militarily, they were getting their asses kicked, and they got their asses kicked again and again and again, right from the word go up until the last 4 or 5 years of the war. The French were getting their butts kicked, but they shouldn't have been. By rights, if you look at the numbers and the figures, from the very outset of the Hundred Years' War in 1337, when Edward III invaded France to pursue his claim to the throne of France, we should have been getting our butts kicked. There's no way we should have done as well as we did. No way. Now, there's a few reasons why I say that. Firstly, I mean, there's reasons why we did do as well as we did, but there's reasons why we shouldn't have. Now, the first thing we've got to look at from that point of view is the numbers. The French had numerical superiority in every way, shape and form. In virtually all of the battles that took place during the Hundred Years' War, the French had a 2-to-1 numerical superiority. In some of them, like for instance Agincourt, depending on which source you look at, but it's generally accepted that the French outnumbered the English 5-to-1. I mean, one extreme spread that's mentioned quite often is 35,000 French against 6,000 English, and the French got their butts kicked. It just shouldn't have happened right from word go. I mean, even the siege of Calais, which was the first battle really, an army of 12,000 English against a population of some 40,000 within Calais, with the French armies coming on as well, it shouldn't have happened. They shouldn't have won. So you've got to ask yourself why. Now, if you look at the figures, the population of France at the time, will ignore the Black Death, the Black Plague, the bubonic plague, because that levelled the population percentages right across Europe. So even though it halved everybody's population, so the numbers still work out the same. Population of France during the Hundred Years' War, beginning the outset of the Hundred Years' War, was approximately 8 million. Population of England, approximately 4 million. Now, if you look at the male population, that gives France a male population of about 4 million and a combat age population of around about 1.5 million. 30% of the male population being 15 to 30 years old. If you look at the same demographic within the English male population, the available manpower comes down to about 700,000. So again, French numerical superiority of about 2 to 1. Now, as it happened, the armies that were actually put together, they maintained that numerical superiority of 2 to 1, almost right across the board. On average, the French would field an army of about 20,000, and on average, the English would field an army of about 10,000. And yet, the English armies still kept winning. Now, if you look in terms of arms and armour that was used by the armies, the French army, most of them were around about 50 to 60% mounted heavy cavalry, men-at-arms and knights, heavily armed, heavily armoured, mounted knights. That should have been enough to decimate any English army that was fighting on foot, as were most of the English soldiers in France during the Hundred Years' War. They fought on foot. Very few mounted units were deployed during the Hundred Years' War, and yet the French continuously lost. Their armies were 60% mounted, approximately 20% mercenary, which we'll talk about again later on, quite a large mercenary contingent, which should have given them a little bit of an edge. I mean, after all, mercenaries are professional soldiers, supposedly, with the remaining 20% made up of feudal levies. So no matter which way you look at it, numerically and equipment-wise, arms and armour-wise, the French should have won, should have decimated the English armies. But if you look at the English army, so you have a completely feudal French army. The difference is between the English and the French. The French army was purely feudal. The call went out and levies were raised, retinues were raised, and everybody went off to war out of a sense of fealty, of duty to the crown. The call had gone out from the king and you answered the call. Now in England it was a little bit different. There was a nuance. It was still feudal. The call went out from the king, and all the landowners, from the highest ranking duke all the way down to the lowliest knight or squire, raised a levy or a retinue and went off to war. The difference was, when the English retinues and levies arrived at their muster points, they were paid money, massive incentive to fight well. On top of that, they were trained. The feudal levies, which made up 20% of the French army, made up almost 80 to 90% of the English army. Big difference. Now you would think, if you just saw it wrote down, French army, feudal levy 20%. English army, feudal level 80%, you'd think feudal levies, oh, they're going to get their butts kicked. Well, they didn't, because they were trained. They were archers. Most of the English armies fielded during the Hundred Years' War were split 50-50, almost exclusively, archers and men-at-arms. Now, the men-at-arms were trained and equipped. A lot of them were actually members of minor nobility and knights in their own right. For instance, a knight would still have to raise a retinue, and quite often a retinue would consist of his younger brothers, in addition to some of the stronger, more strapping lads from the village or whatever, but they would still be trained because Edward I had put in place regulations whereby everybody who reported for military service through the feudal system had to be trained to a certain standard. For instance, archers had to be able to shoot 12 arrows a minute to command. Men-at-arms had to be able to hold the line as part of a unit and then fight. They had to be trained. They also had to be equipped. Now some of the equipment had to be provided by the soldier themselves. A lot of it, especially in the case of the men-at-arms, had to be provided by their feudal landlord. But at the end of the day, when they arrived at muster, they were still paid. Now that's a big incentive. There was something else which was a big incentive as well, and a big difference between the English and the French armies. Now the French armies, if you were a member of the nobility, you could gain promotion, you could gain prestige through sterling military service. However, it was, if you were below the rank of knight, you had no chance. If you were a feudal levy, you had absolutely no chance of gaining promotion or advancement at all. However, in the English army you did. Now, there was this comes down to Edward I. When he was raising armies at the end of the 13th century, at the end of the 1300s, to go to war with Scotland. He was actually keeping an eye on people, and he was promoting people. He was promoting from within the units. For instance, a captain of archers wouldn't be a knight or a nobleman who said, right, okay, go over there, you're in command of them. He would actually promote somebody from within that unit of archers. Okay, it might be a member of a minor household. For instance, you remember the Falvilles we talked about during the outlaw video? It's known that the two younger sons of the Falville family went off to war with Edward in Scotland, and as a result, they became captains of archers. They had no lands of their own, they had no title of their own, they had no wealth of their own, but as a result of being noticed on the battlefields in Scotland, they were knighted. They became captains of archers, they were knighted, and then they were given granted lands, and they actually progressed as a result of military service. They had social mobility and military mobility. It was entirely possible for a feudal levy who had no rank whatsoever to be noticed by somebody and be taken on as a squire. Now a squire, contrary to popular misconception, the squire is the lowest rank of the English nobility. Once you're a squire, doors open for you. You were usually granted a small piece of land somewhere. It might just be to manage it, but you still got to make money off it. Once you started making money from being a squire, that's actually where the name farmer comes from as well. It was a squire who was given a piece of land to manage. Once you were making money, you could go to court. You were a squire, you could go to the royal court. You could become noticed in the corridors of power. Doors open for you. So you had military mobility and social mobility. People were knighted on the battlefield for sterling military service, and with knighthood came wealth and prestige. So that was another difference between the English feudal armies and the French feudal armies. So, on paper, the French should have been kicking the English butt, but they weren't, because of the incentives. Even though they outnumbered the English 2-1, the English armies that went over to France during the Hundred Years' War were professional. They were trained and they were paid. Now, one of the downfalls of the system put in place by Edward I, is probably one of the things that resulted in English armies being so small. Now, what you've got to remember, we've actually discussed the numbers available. For the population of England at the time, there was a possible manpower base of 15 to 30 year olds of about 80,000 combat-aged males available to take part in the campaigns against the French. So why didn't the English kings, like from Edward III onwards, raise an army of 80,000? I mean, 80,000, a professional army of 80,000, trained, well-equipped, disciplined soldiers would have absolutely decimated the French to the point that the Hundred Years' War would probably have been more like a 10 Years' War, and Edward III would have been on the throne of France, and who knows where it would have led from there. And I honestly do think that they would have an army of 80,000 English split 50-50 between men-at-arms and archers would have decimated any French army, because the biggest army they seemed to be able to raise was about 30,000. Who knows? Anyway, but why was that? Well, as I've already said, Edward I put in place the idea of paying soldiers, creating a professional army. But something else he put in place as well, which is sort of a good idea, but I think it was taken advantage of, was called scutage, or scutage, depending on whether you're French or English. And basically what that was the ability for anybody to avoid military service by paying what was basically called a shield payment, a shield fine, scutage, from the French heraldic escutcheon, meaning shield or protective place, protective shield. And basically a nobleman who didn't want to go on campaign for whatever reason. Now don't forget, England is recovering from the Black Death. So a lot of people were thinking, right, I need to stay here on my land and get my affairs in order. I need to get my business up and running again. I need to get the farm working again. Because a lot of the workforce had died off. So a lot of noblemen stayed at home. And they could do that legally by paying scutage or scutage of 100 shillings. A minor landowner, a squire possibly, or an artisan, a merchant, could avoid the same by paying 30 shillings. A peasant farmer, 5 shillings. Now the idea behind this scutage, behind this shield payment, was to give the monarch the opportunity to raise mercenary armies to replace the English that didn't go to war. Unfortunately, irony upon ironies, when we get to the Hundred Years' War, the French have hired them all. They've hired almost every mercenary that's available throughout continental Europe, from Germany to Italy, Flemish crossbowmen, every possible mercenary they could find, they hired to bolster their armies, and they still got their butts kicked. It's quite a delicious irony that the French just kept losing, and how dare we English insist on winning against them. As I said, the Hundred Years' War, once you start looking behind the battles, it's actually really, really quite interesting. There's lots more to it than what I've gone over. For instance, the effect of the Black Death, the effects of other wars that were going on at the time. For instance, the Mongols raiding into Hungary and Turkey and places like that, which was all part and parcel of medieval life in the Hundred Years, during the Hundred Years' War period. Quite an interesting period of time. Anyway, I've rabbited on enough. Hope you found that interesting. Not too boring, but stay safe, keep slinging the sticks, and we'll talk again soon. Cheers, guys. If you'd like to know more about the battles of the Hundred Years' War, go and visit Kevin Hicks at the History Squad YouTube channel. Tell him I sent you.